Thank you so much, Professor Sasanka Pereira. I think it was quite enlightening discussion, particularly about challenging theory and coming up with your own theoretical approaches. And of course, all the rest of work that you've done, and I think it's not just related to, you keep saying social sciences very religiously because you belong to social sciences background, but I think it's very creative and literary as well. So I welcome any questions from students. G. Malika, I'm afraid you'll have to move to the front because there may be an echo. So we have a question coming up from
Malika. Sure, sure. Yeah.
You come here in front of the camera.
And, no, that's completely fine.
And also my colleague Nadia Iftikhar has joined. She's the graduate seminar coordinator and she will thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for this enlightening talk.
I would
like to comment that the colloquial style of you really made it a refreshing talk, and I hope our students must have enjoyed it. I would wish that you be having another session on maybe the extension of this, because you know, when you speak in a refreshing kind of way and don't make it a monotony, students always learn more. So I really appreciate your colloquial expression and the way you expressed all the things in detail. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining.
Nadia, thank you for saying that, because people get very upset with me when I speak like this. But as I was saying, when people reach my kind of seniority, I don't really have to give a damn. So, but the point is, they do get upset. So, but
to me, because when you complicate the concepts, you know, students always distracted and they are detached.
Yeah,
so in order to have an association with the students, you need to come up to their academic level, their colloquial level, and their you need to join them from their core. So this was the part that I really enjoyed. You enjoyed them from their core, and you came up with really good points.
Wonderful, wonderful. Good
Thank
to know.
You, Ms. Nadia. Okay, one question from a student. Ji, tell your name, please.
Malika.
Okay. Okay, she's there. Okay. Okay. Okay, please ask.
Okay, so the question is, I actually wanted to know about, because you said there is this, in your words, you said there is this innovative way to go about research, and you called it nuanced way. And you say that it can be both in methodology and theory as well. But my question is related to theory. I personally believe that philosophy is incompatible with creativity. This is my personal belief. So I will explain it in a way that, because to be creative, you have to be open to new, to experiment, to come up with something. You have to give your subconscious an ultimate freedom so that it comes up with a groundbreaking idea that has never been conceived before. So this is creativity. You have to give this freedom to your subconscious. But philosophy, on the other part, or I would like to say theory, as a philosophical construct, it kind of directs the thought of a researcher. It freezes the subconscious in advance. It tells you how to go about your research. This is, for instance, this is deconstruction. This is a construction. This is modernism. This is postmodernism. It already tells you what it is and how you should go about it. Then, if we are going to be creative, then don't you think including theory or the application of theory in our research is kind of useless? And what is the role of theory if we have to be creative? And for to be creative, we have to reject the previous notion so that we can come up with a new idea. Then what is the role of theory? Why are we including theory that we clearly perceive that has no position or no role, it doesn't fit in? Then why do we feel that the theory has to be included? We can come up with our own theory with every single research.
Okay. I get it. See, I think you're taking the word creative very literally here, right? What I mean by creative is to be flexible, is to be not dominated by dogmatic positions, to be open to ideas, that kind of thing. So we can replace the word creative and use something else. Let's say open, flexible. But for me, the problem is this, only when we are talking about theory, right? I think, you know, there was not too long ago, there was a book I read in a Singapore airport, and the title was Can Asians Think? This has been, it's a bad book, but it's a very interesting title. Now, what I'm trying to ask is this. Are we sure that the kind of theoretical constructs that we are dealing with now in our work, whether it's social sciences or humanities or whatever, are they capable of addressing our concerns, engaging with the kinds of problems or problematics that we want to deal with? Are they good enough? Are we sure that these kinds of theoretical positions that came from a particular historical moment in Europe be able to investigate our problems, investigate our issues without engaging with? That is why Akbar Zaidi was also saying that you don't really question the theory, that we don't question the theory. So when I say creative, I am talking to that, I'm talking about that process, right? I am not saying that the theory can be creative in the sense of fiction so that it can be anything goes kind of. That is not what I'm saying, right? Because in the end, we have to make sure that our work is driven by theory. For that, it has to be robust, right? It has to explain something. Now, you can't do that if it's creative in the sense of fiction. When I say creative, I am talking about being innovative in terms of building a particular theoretical body of theoretical work, which is what one thing I can do is send to either Nadia or Nokpa the syllabus of our theory course, which might give some of you people ideas about how we are trying to approach this, right? It might be a kind of a point of departure if you are interested.
Yeah, sure, sir. Please do.
We'll do that.
Yeah, sure.
So thanks for the question.
This is the last thing that I would like to say.
Is your question addressed?
Yes. He mentioned this book where the author talks about the theory either fascinates us or either frustrates us. Because if it fascinates us, we can expand on it. But if it frustrates us, we can come up with a new construct. Mm-hmm. And I think in that way, it does address. We can take the theory and then we can either expand or
challenge it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Any more questions?
I can send that paper too, by the way, if anyone wants to read.
Please. Thank you. Rami?
Yeah, please.
Yes. Can you hear us?
You talked about publishers and the pressure that the publishers put on the authors, but you know, right now we are just studying, and we are not in the hands of publishers, but rather university and the board who decides our topics. And the thing is that there, you talk about gatekeeping as well. And the trend that I see, you focused on social sciences, but the trend that I've seen in languages and English, that students are not even allowed to, do their research work on fan fiction or on pulp fiction or on magazines or, they are not allowed to even do memoirs or stray from the novel. And there is this sort of dictatorship of novel as well. Many students choose novel, but only a few might choose plays, drama, or poetry. And I have no idea why this trend is catching fire in the languages. But you might have something to say about it. This gatekeeping that our supervisors and our university system does. And students are, almost forced to, research in the same manner year and year again and again. So I just want to know what you have to say about that.
Ji, we can't hear you anymore.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I had muted myself. I didn't really hear you very clearly, but it seems to me that you are asking about gatekeepers, that Are you asking whether students are not allowed to publish certain things in magazines or whatever because they are kind of copyrighted? Is that what you are saying?
No, no. Actually, her question is that, for instance, we had this discussion earlier in this class today, that somebody is using kind of memoirs and pulp fiction in their research as a primary source for their thesis. Her question is about, don't you think the supervisors, universities, and review boards that review proposals become gatekeepers?
Well, right? They are, they are, absolutely. I mean, so we have had students, absolutely. This is what I was saying. This is what I meant by also being creative. So some of these guys are, let's not use the word creative. It might confuse, people in language studies like you. You have to be a bit more, this is also what I referred to when my senior colleagues ask me they no longer ask me these questions, but people like you, students, whether your work is adequately sociological, right? And that is being asked the moment they are not using conventional methods, right? The moment they are using, if it's pulp fiction, you are dead. Right, because they cannot fathom how can, I mean, I think, it's the same question for poetry, fiction, or any, it doesn't matter if it's pulp fiction, even if it's poetry, even if it's Rumi, you can't, the general assumption is that they cannot be brought into something as formal and methodologically robust as social sciences. But this is a misnomer, right? Now, nobody should be arguing that, let's say, we take your example, pulp fiction, right? Now, why do we have to assume that whether it's pulp fiction or whether it's a particular archive of photography, right? That somehow these sources have to tell a particular story by themselves. Now, we are not making that argument, right? All we are saying, all people like me are saying, and perhaps you too, is it not possible to give these kinds of sources a respectable hearing in our research? That's all, right? And to do that, of course, you can't tell a story by itself. You know, this. You obviously you will combine your methods. That is what interpretation is all about. You're not going to bring a work of pulp fiction into an ethnography and say, this is it. It is not how it works. It will work, it can work like any other methodological device, any other approach. That is why I was trying to tell you that I could not, I wrote a book in 2012 on photography, on art and violence in Sri Lanka. It became a chapter in one of the books I referred to later. I'm telling you, it was impossible for me to talk about civil war in Sri Lanka at the time up to 2008 without looking at this artwork, right? It was impossible. I mean, people have written about this without looking at those kinds of things. You talk to people, you look at the parliamentary debates and the regular social science sources. Fine, I also looked at them. But I think I am pretty certain that if I had not done that, the kind of analysis I came up with would have been like everybody else's. It would have been woefully incomplete, right? But of course, people are criticizing me for that, saying it's very subjective and it cannot be quantified and all that kind of stuff. Now, we have known about this, I don't know whether you heard of this thing called the writing culture debate that came from American anthropology in about 1980s. And that one of the things it said was that whatever we do, even if you don't use those kinds of methodological approaches, the kind of writing we do on behalf of our disciplines are a kind of partial truths, always, right? And that is because we don't necessarily present what we hear from the field. It goes through a particular process of interpretation. and it comes from our theoretical apparatuses. It comes from our training, right? A language scholar will look at a particular thing differently from a sociologist. So all these interpretations make what we write incomplete in that sense about those about what we describe. So if that's the case, and that is with regard to conventional approaches, which are supposed to be more sound, so then why not pulp fiction? Why not photography? But see, the question is that things don't come close to why not, because it is often stopped long before that. I know students have come to our university, to my department, without applying to more established places. There were not a lot, but one or two, because they were saying that they could not have used some of the approaches that in regular sociology programs, for example, art. And for us, it's an open thing, right? Okay. Sorry, I took too long.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Anyone else who wants to ask a question? Okay, I think, thank you so much for your enlightening talk and discussion, and breaking the conventions. Intelligent theory is the best one. And thank you for sparing the time. And sure. We would love to read your work. If you want to share any article, I'll be sharing them with the students.
Okay, I will send you some.
We'll be in touch. Thank you, Nadia, for joining us.
You take care. I will see you around.
And we have one student, Rao Rajacha, who has joined us as well. Thank you so much. And thank you on behalf of English department.
Sure. All right, Nadia.
Thank you, sir. I hope we'll carry your legacy of addressing, questioning the already established canons in our way.
Yeah, you should. Otherwise, life will be very boring. No? All right, you take care. If you need me, my help again, please feel free to let me know.
Sure, sir. I would wish that you be sending me the paper you mentioned.
The what?
The paper, the research paper that you mentioned.
I will send it to you. If I don't by tomorrow, please send me a reminder.
Thank you.
Okay,
we
sure, sir.
Remind you.
All right.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone, for joining. Bye.